إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله Man, when he thinks about himself and the universe around him, the first thing that comes into his mind, the first question, who am I? What am I doing here? Why am I fooling around here? And what is happening around me? Why we see the sequence of day and night? So he thinks, who am I and what is the universe? These are the two basic questions. I should know myself, and second thing, I should know my surrounding. The third thing, who made me? And who made this universe? What is my origin? And what will be my end? What is my past? And what is my future? Now, he finds then, the third question is very important. The first problem was to know myself. The second problem was to know about the universe. The third question is, who made this? Who is running the show? Who is the master? So the third question is a little tricky and disputable. Now, it's a puzzle. You have to solve this puzzle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided that He will give some clues, and based on those clues, you have to know Him. He does not come directly, and He doesn't come and talk to every man. You know, He doesn't come on the sky and say, ladies and gentlemen, I am your creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't show His face. He's hiding. And one of the meanings of ilah, when you say la ilaha illallah, one of the meanings, there are eight meanings of the word ilah. One of the meanings of ilah is that one who is hiding. Aliha ihtajaba, ihtajaba. He is hiding, he's in hijab. And that's what it is said in Surah Al-Hadid, wal awwal, wal aqib, wal zahir, wal batin. He is apparent by his signs, but he is batin. He is hiding as far as his own self is concerned. Now, with the signs, you have to know your God. With the signs. For example, you smell odor or smoke. You know, you tell, oh, I'm smelling something. There must be a fire. You don't see the fire, you smell only. And with the smell, you reach to the conclusion there must be a fire. A ship is moving, and you see them, you know, you are at the bank, at the shore, and the ship is moving, you conclude that there must be a man, a captain of this ship, who is making it flow in the water. So similarly, men always thinks that there is a creator who created us and who created the universe. But the problem with man was always that he came to a wrong conclusion, and he thought creation is God. So they started worshipping sun, they started worshipping moon, they started worshipping stars, they started worshipping trees, and the people of Iran, they started worshipping fire. Some of the people in the islands, they started worshipping oceans and typhoons. When the typhoon comes and kills so many people, they think, this is the God in the ocean who kills us. And sometimes, the holy people, the noble people, who were leading mankind towards God, they were made God. For example, Rama and Krishna and Buddha and so many other gods you have, Jesus Christ, Mary, good people, they were made gods. Sometimes prophets were made God. Sometimes bad people were considered God, like Faraina, and they had power, they were killing people, they were ruling people. People thought, since they have the might, they should be worshipped. Now, there are a lot of philosophies, lot of religions, lot of ideas in this world. We have Christianity, we have Hinduism, we have Buddhism, we have Shintoism, we have Christianity, we have Judaism, and other religions, small religions. According to Islam, there are two methods to reach to the right conclusion. Number one, like Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّ فِي قَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتِ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. In fact, in the creation of earth and heavens, and changing of day and night, there are signs, ayat liulil albab, for the people who ponder, who think. There are signs of what? Those people who understand Arabic. All the time in the Quran, when it comes, inna fi zalika la ayah, inna fi zalika la ayat. So mudaf ilay is always hidden there. Ayatul tawheed, ayatul qudra, ayatul akhira, inna fi zalika la ayah, ayatul tawheed li ulil albab. So, in the creation of earth and heavens, there are signs of His greatness, His oneness, His qudra, His hikmah, His wisdom. That one being is only running the show, not many gods, only one. The God of sun and God of moon is the same. There are there is only one functional God, active God. فَعَالُ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. There is only one who is running the show. If there would have been many gods, you would notice a conflict in this universe. Second thing, as I told you, merely with pondering, one cannot have the right concept of God. Man is dependent on revelation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to Islam, man cannot understand God. Man cannot understand himself. Man cannot understand the universe. These are the three questions. Man, universe, and God. So he cannot know precisely with only experimentation, observation, philosophy, poetry, science, technology. You cannot reach to the precise right conclusion. Man is dependent on revelation. Al-Wahyu. Al-Wahyu. And this is what Islam teaches. So the first man, Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, was made a prophet. So the rules were set. The rules were set on the first day. What were the rules? Allah will be hiding. His signs will be apparent. He will provide guidance through prophets. Angels will come on prophets and messengers. And books shall be given to them. Wahi, al-wahi will be given to them. Angels will be sent, messengers will be sent, and through them the guidance of mankind is possible. Books shall be given to some of them, through which the guidance is possible. Now, after Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, so many prophets were sent. 124,000 prophets and 315 messengers. Messengers are little elevated and prophets are little inferior. Every messenger is a prophet, but every messenger, he is a prophet, but every prophet is not a messenger. And they have also degrees. تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَدَّلْنَا بَعْدَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْدٍ. And similarly, these 124,000 prophets, they have different degrees. Some are elevated, some are not. Out of this 315, five of them are Ulul Azm. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, of 3,500 BC, approximately. 3,500 BC. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam of 2,100 BC, approximately. And Musa alayhi salatu wasalam of 1,300 BC, approximately. And the Christ, you know, 2,000 years ago. And the last one is Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wasallam, born in 571, made prophet in 610, and he died in 632, Christian era AD. Now, you must know, these prophets and these messengers are selected human beings. They are not God.
MashaAllah.
They are not God. And that is what is told from the mouth of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Innama ana basharum mislukum yuha ilayya. Two things are very important here. Innama, the first part is innama ana basharum mislukum. The second part is yuha ilayya. These two parts you have to understand very well. That all prophets and all messengers are bashar. They are human beings. They sleep. They marry. They have a date of birth. They die. They are killed sometimes. They eat. They marry. They go to their wives. They have children. They get sick. They get injured in the war. Sometimes they are killed. They are human beings. They are not like God. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not sleep. He doesn't get tired. He never makes mistakes. He never forbids. وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. He is lam yalid. He is lam yulad. He has no nid. He has no andad. He has no kuf. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدٍ. And لَا تَخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. He doesn't get sleep. وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبٍ. He doesn't get tired. And the protection of heavens and earth. وَلَا يَهُودُهُ حِفْسُهُمَا. The protection of heavens and earth is a difficult job, but He doesn't get tired. God is perfect. He has no defect. When you say Subhanallah, when you say Subhanallah, it means I acknowledge, I accept, I declare that Allah does not sleep. He is free from all defects. Now, this knowledge about God, the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cannot be discovered by philosophy, cannot be discovered by science. Only a prophet can explain this. Only a prophet can explain this. And prophet cannot explain without yuha ilay. Innama ana basharum mislukum yuha ilay. I am also a man like all of you, but the greatest difference between you and the Prophet, that he gets revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he speaks, Allah puts words in his mouth. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. So Abdullah bin Amr bin Al-As, the famous Sahabi, he said, Rasulullah says, "Uktub, write down whatever I say." So he objected and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, sometimes you make jokes, sometimes you are angry." So he said, "I swear to my God, even when I'm angry, my anger is also from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I smile and I cut jokes, it is also from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So this you have to understand, the nature of prophethood. Nature of prophethood. You have to understand Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam as he is. You have to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he is. This is A, B, C of Islam. If you don't know the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the right concept and right attributes of Allah, then you are astray. And if you don't know the right qualities of a prophet and a messenger, especially Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are gone. You cannot reach the right path. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنَّ عَلَيْنَا لَلْهُدَى وَإِنَّ عَلَيْنَا لَلْهُدَى. It is our job, it is our responsibility. إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا, it is our responsibility to give you guidance. You know, why should I know about God? He should tell me who He is. He is hiding Himself. So He should tell me. You know, I cannot take His picture. He doesn't come on TV. He doesn't appear on the sky. I am not able to make a telephone call. I am not able to give Him a telex message or a fax message. So He should communicate with man. It is His responsibility, and He's accepted. And He said, Inna alayna lal-huda. It is our responsibility to guide. And He has opted one option only. And that option is, I shall give you hidayah through my angels, through my prophets and messengers, and through my books. God is very merciful to mankind. He does not leave the mankind at any stage without prophets and messengers and angels and books. This is the Rahman. And He is asking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking everybody, inviting towards Jannah. Allah wants every Japanese to be in Jannah. Allah wants every American to be in paradise. Allah wants every Jew to be in Jannah. Wallahu yad'u ila daris salam. Daris salam, He is inviting you to daris salam, the house of salam, house of peace. Jannah is house of peace. If they don't want to enter into the house of peace, it is their option. فَإِمَّا شَاكِرٌ وَإِمَّا كَفُورٌ إِنَّا هَدَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلِ. We have guided you as-sabil, al-Islam, al-Huda, al-Nur. إِنَّا هَدَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلِ, as-sabil. You are given a freedom of choice. You can have no compulsion in Islam. لا إكراه في الدين. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Whosoever wants, he can accept Islam. Whosoever wants, he can reject this call, this invitation, this da'wah. He can reject. No compulsion. No compulsion. لا إكراه في الدين. But he wants every man to enter paradise. There is no ayah in the Quran in which Allah says, please come to hell. He wants three things. Number one, He wants to tell the people who they are, who is man. And He wants to tell mankind who is God, and what is universe, and what is the function of man in this universe. خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. He has created a system of life and death so that He can test mankind. أيكم أحسن عملا. Who is better in his deeds and actions? How many marks you secure? How many how many? You? 40%, 50%, 70%, 80%, 90%, 95%. Ayyukum ahsanu amala. How many marks you secured? What grade you will get? A grade, B grade, C grade, or F grade? Ayyukum ahsanu amala. Liyabluwakum. Liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala. Now, these prophets, they come in this universe, like Allah says, Rusulan Mubashirina wa Munzirin. Mubashirina wa Munzirin. All these messengers, they come as Mubashir. They give glad tidings of paradise. And they are munzirin, they are warners. They warn from the torture of this dunya and the torture of the akhirah. Munzirin. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also a munzir and he is also a mubashir. He is bashir and he is nazir. Now, these prophets, they have five basic responsibilities. Five basic responsibilities. Number one, every prophet, every messenger, the first thing he comes and talks, he says, Ma lakum min ilahin ghayr. Ma lakum min ilahin ghayr. For you, there is no other ilah except him. مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُ. This is the first point from Adam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Only out of this 124,000 prophets, only 25 of them are mentioned in the Quran. Only 25. And maybe one or two are mentioned in ahadith, like Yosha bin Nun, who was assistant to Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. In hadith, it is mentioned. Lam naqsus alayk, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we did not mention all of them to you. Only few of them are mentioned. So first job of the Prophet or Nabi or Rasul, he says, Ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. You have to accept that God is one. He has no son, he has no father, he has no date of birth, he is from the beginning, he has no date of death, he doesn't die. Al-Hayyu, Al-Qayyum. We are also alive, but one day we have to die. Kullu man alayha fan, wa yabqa wajhu rabbika zul jalali wal ikram, kullu shay'in halikun illa wajha. Everything has to perish. Everything has to die. Except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Illa wajh. This is the God. A perfect God with 100% knowledge. With 100% power. He has 100% knowledge and 100% power. He is alimum bizati sudur. He knows our intentions and motives. Wahuwa bikulli shay'in alim. He has knowledge of every element and compound. Alim, bikulli shayin alim. And he has the power over every element and compound. Wahuwa ala kulli shayin qadir. Now, the second job of the Prophet is, he invites mankind, worship Allah. U'budullah, u'budullah. Like in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 21, it is clearly said, Ya ayyuhan nas, u'budu rabbakum, allazi khalaqakum, wallazina min qablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon. O mankind, u'budu rabbakum, allazi khalaqakum, You see, here, try to understand these three words. Three words are very important. First one is Ubudu, worship. Second one is Rabbakum. The third one is Allazi Khalaq. Actually, these three words, Ubudu, Rabbakum, Khalaqakum. We change the sequence. The first thing is, He is Khaliq. He is the creator. He created us. He created everything in the universe. Since He is the creator, He should be worshipped. Number two, He is Rabb. He is sustainer. He is provider. He is giving us oxygen. He is giving us water and rains. He is giving us distilled water. He is giving us fruits and vegetables. He is providing an atmosphere which is very suitable for the mankind, for the existence of mankind on this planet. He is Rabb. He is the Lord. Listen to me very carefully. He did not create and He isolated Himself. Now somebody else is running the show. No. Like in engineering, you say, build and operate. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is builder and He is the operator. He is Khaliq and He is Rabb. He is Khaliq and Rabb. Now the demand comes, Ubudu. So you should worship only the creator. You should not worship the creation. You should not worship sun. You should not worship oceans. You should not worship fire. You should not worship cow. You should not worship elephants. You should not worship human beings. You should not worship prophets and good people or bad people. You should worship the creator. The creator God and the Rabb God. And these are not two different gods. The same God is creator and the same God is active. فَعَالُ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. He's not a sleeping God. You know, He did not create the world and He did not put it on automation and then now He is sleeping. No. Like some of the philosophers said, well, there is a creator, there is a Khaliq, but now He is not active. He's isolated Himself. He isolated Himself, He's sleeping. No, Allah does not sleep. لَا تَخُذُهُ سِنَةٌ وَلَا نَوْمٌ. He's fa'al. He is active. He's fa'al. فَعَالُ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. He's Rabb. He is providing everything. رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ. Now, the first job of the Prophet is to declare that there is only one God. The second job of the Prophet to ask people, you should worship Allah alone, Ubudullah. The third thing the Prophet comes and tells, Ati'uni. I am the Prophet of this time. You should obey me. And ultimately, the last Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam came when the previous teachings of Christianity and Judaism were distorted, when the books were distorted. All the Jews, without any exception, all the Jewish scholars, they admit the fact that Torah is not in the original language that was given to Moses, Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. Because it was given in Hebrew and later on, you know, they lost the Bible. Torah was given in 1300 BC. Within 5 years after Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, they lost it. And Allah punished them. Bukht-e-Nasr came and he killed them and he expelled them from Baytul Maqdis. Then Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam came and he dictated Torah again to them. But the Jews, they were under the influence of Romans. They translated Torah into Roman and the original Hebrew script was lost. And they translated into many other languages. Torah was lost. And Allah punished them second time. And that's what Allah said in the Quran, لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ, that you will make fasad on the earth two times and you shall get the punishment. And they got it. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent the gospel, Anajil, Injil, Al-Injil. But again, the language of Isa alayhi salatu wa salam was Aramaic. It was lost. Hebrew and Roman and so many other translations were made. Now we don't find the original Bible as it was given by Jesus Christ. Ultimately Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam came. Now the fourth demand of the prophets and messengers especially, that you must fight Taghut. You see, Surah An-Nahl, ayah number 36. Surah An-Nahl, ayah number 36. Allah says, I have sent all Rusul, not one, all of them, all 315 messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عَنَيْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاشْتَنِبُ الْتَاغُوتِ عَنَيْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَاشْتَنِبُ الْتَاغُوتِ. You must worship only one Allah and you must refrain from Taghut. You must refrain from Taghut. Who is Taghut? اِذْهَبِ إِلَى فِرْعَوْنِ فَإِنَّهُ طَغَى. Who is Taghut? Namrud is Taghut. Fir'aun is Taghut. كَذَّبَتْ Samud بِتَقْوَاهَا. The nation of Samud was Taghut. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ الطَّاغُوتِ فَقَاتِلُوا أَوْلِيَاءَ الشَّيْطَانِ. Bashar al-Assad, he's a Taghut. He's a Taghut. He's killing innocent people. Ladies, boys and girls, the monks in Burma, Myanmar, I saw a video, 1 year old boy, he was giving electric shocks, 1 year old boy. I have seen this video about Myanmar. These are Taghut. Taghut. So every prophet comes into this world and he says, Anibudullah washtanibut Taghut. Anibudullah washtanibut Taghut. Do this, don't do this. Obey Allah, worship Allah. And obey Allah, worship Allah. U'budu. Listen to me very carefully. U'budu also means ati'u. Like in the Quran says, La ta'budu shaitan. La ta'budu shaitan. Don't make ibadah of shaitan means what? Does anybody say, Allahu Akbar, I make 2 rakat for shaitan? Allah is saying, don't, la ta'budu shaitan means, la tuti'u shaitan. Ibadah means ita'. Ibadah also means, doing this, making ruku, making sajda. Ibadah means to make dua. This is also ibadah. There are different types of ibadah. And Imam Razi rahimahullah said, أسأب أقسام العبادة الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. أقسم أسأب. The most difficult type of ibadah is to tell people that this is good and this is bad. Stop. Refrain from it. أصعب أقسام العبادة الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah رحمه الله, he said, كل, يعني he quoted so many ahadith, كل معروف صدق. So, when you say Subhanallah, it is ibadah. When you say Alhamdulillah, it is ibadah. When you say Allahu Akbar, it is ibadah. When you say don't drink liquor, that is ibadah. Don't rape, that is ibadah. When you order something good, when you stop from evil, that is also ibadah. That is ibadah. Hatta Imam Ibn Taymiyyah said in his famous the book Al-Ubudiyyah, he said Ima tatul adha ani tariq, you get the reward. If you clean the road and you remove the obstruction from the road and you make it flow, the traffic goes, that is also ibadah. So the concept of ibadah is very, 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 very wide in Islam. And the last thing, the fifth function of the Rasul is to establish adl, justice, to make sure the people stand for justice. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا رُسُلُنَا بِالْبَيِّنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَا وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. Suratul Hadid, ayah number 25. Suratul Hadid, ayah number 25. That we have sent messengers. لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا. رُسُلَنَا. Surah number 57, ayah number 25, the golden ayah of the Quran. We have sent all messengers with bayyinat, with crystal clear teachings, bayyinat, without any ambiguity, bayyinat. Wa anzalna ma'humul kitaba wal mizan. And they were given, every messenger comes with a book and a scale. Remember, Prophet's job is not only to come and lead the prayer. He comes for social justice. He comes for economic justice. Go back to the Quran. Go back to the Quran. Read Suratul Hadid, ayah number 25. Memorize it. Repeat after me. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بالقسط ليقوم الناس بالقسط ليقوم الناس بالقسط. All messengers, all rusul, they come to make sure that people are on justice, irrespective of Muslims or non-Muslims. Wherever there is injustice, a Muslim must stand. He should not say, well, for example, a Christian and a Jew, both are fighting. A Hindu and a Buddhist, they are fighting, for example. We cannot say, well, let them fight. Why should we enter into it? No. It is our job to see who is just and who is oppressed. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. Allah did not say, لِيَقُومَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ. مُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْقِسْطِ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. So that mankind stands for justice. So, what I said, five things. Number one, Number one, every Rasul comes, first thing he says, Malakum min ilahin ghayru. You must accept one God, one ilah. There is no ilah other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, they invite people, they call people and say, Ubudullah, Ubudullah. Worship Allah alone. The third thing, Ati'uni. Follow me, I am the prophet of my time. Then, fourth thing, Ishtanibut Tahoot. Refrain from Tahoot. Stay away from those forces who are tyrant. And the last thing that Rasul come here to establish social justice, economic justice. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about zakat, تُخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِكُمْ وَتُرَدُّ إِلَى فُقَرَائِكُمْ. This zakat will be taken from your rich people and it will be distributed among your poor people. So Rasul's job is not only to lead the prayer in the masjid and to say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Rasul's job is to fight against Tawud. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ التَّاغُوتِ فَقَاتِلُوا أَوْلِيَاءَ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. And لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعْهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ. So my dear brothers, my question to you, do you have the scale in your hand? Do you have mizan? Do you have mizan? Are you weighing ideas and personalities and people and nations and countries? You don't have the mizan in your hand. Rasul comes with the mizan. You don't have the mizan. You are not standing for justice. You think you will get paradise only by coming to masjid? No. Follow the Rasul. Ihdina sirata allazina an'amta alayhim. Who are an'amta alayhim? Rasul. Who are an'amta alayhim? Rasul, Anbiya, Rasul, Siddiqeen, Shuhada, Salihin. They are the people who are an'amta alayhim. Now, it is said about Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Suratul A'raf, ayah number 157. What is the job of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Yada'u anhum israhum. Yada'u anhum isra. What is the job of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You see, as if, you know, I'm walking like this and I have 200 kgs of load on my back. I cannot move, you know, I'm moving very slowly because I have 200 kgs on my back. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming and taking the load from my shoulder. Now I can stand, you know, straight forward. I can go very fast because I'm relieved. I'm liberated. I don't have the load. Yada'u anhum israhum. Yada'u anhum israhum. Try to understand the role of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is his job? He's making you lighter. He's taking off the load on from your shoulder. وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has witnessed that you have ropes in your necks. In your neck you have lot of ropes, aghlal. You know, ring after ring. You cannot even look down because of, You know, one rope, second rope, third rope, you know, you can see only toward the sky. How can you travel? You cannot see what is in front of you. You, because the ropes are full in your neck. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes and he takes all the ropes away from your neck, and you can see, you know, on your right, on your left, down, in front. He makes you liberated. Try to understand Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, life becomes very, very easy for you. Life becomes very easy for you. Your social life, your family life, your jobs, everything becomes peaceful. And Allah has guaranteed two things. Remember here, two things. Since Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet, his book is kept intact in original Arabic language, and he gave a guarantee in Surah Al-Hijr, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikr wa inna lahu lahafiz. We have revealed this Quran and we shall protect it until the day of judgment. Wa inna lahu lahafizun. There were a lot of efforts to distort this book, and still a lot of efforts are going on, but they will all be futile. Now, second thing, you must know that there is no other personality in the world whose life history is same like the history of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You go to Mr. Google, ask Mr. Google. You ask Sheikh Google, you see, you ask him the life of Jesus Christ. You will not find anything. His childhood, you know, his friends, you know, you will get very, very little knowledge. But the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they noted and memorized each and every single word as well as action of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even the private matters, when he was kissing his wife, that is also noted and registered. When he was approaching his wife, what dua he was making, that is registered. When he was eating, when he was entering the mosque, when he was sleeping, every time what was his sunnah, that is noted and transmitted from generation to generation, from sahaba to tabi'in, from tabi'in to taba tabi'in, and taba tabi'in to taba tabi'in. Tabi'in, the followers were going to sahaba and asking him, you are lucky, you have seen Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Please tell us, what did you see? How many hours you spent with him? How many days you spent with him? Tell us some hadith about him. Give us that picture. Where did you see him? Did you see him in Hajj? Did you see him in Masjid? Did you see him in a war? What was the date? What was the Hijri? In which year? Where were you born? The Tabi'in, they were so curious to know, not only Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were also writing down the history of companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in no other religion of the world, you will see this. No other religion of the world. So, alhamdulillah, we have Sahih al-Bukhari. We have Sahih al-Muslim. These are the two most authentic books after Quran. Brothers, I advise all of you, in your house, you must have the English translation with Arabic text of Sahih Muslim and Sahih Bukhari along with Quran. And you should keep on reading Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. And I advise you to go through the book of Seerah, Zadul Ma'ad, by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi. And find out if this is available on the net and in English, and if the Japanese translation is made of this book. This is the best book of Seerah of Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It gives you the minor details, and this is the authentic book of Seerah. Because there are a lot of unauthentic books also. Many stories without reference. Zadul Ma'ad. Zadul Ma'ad. Zadul Ma'ad is a five-volume detailed seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, in detail, five volumes in Arabic. But you see, in your language, the translation is in Urdu is available, but Zadul Ma'ad. Check Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, who was a disciple of Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, who died in 751 Hijri, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim. So brothers, this was an initial talk about prophethood, about the role of prophethood, and about the responsibilities of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his job. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين واستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. If you have any question, and if the time permits,
yes,
the salah is there.
Yeah, we can have question and answer after that. We can have some.
Satisfy,
yes. Many people, they have a lot of questions, but sometimes suddenly they can't question. I also have many questions. Suddenly cannot.
What were the three things that Allah wanted? Three things which Allah wanted?
Well, you see, the three basic questions. Number one, who are we? Who are we? You know, every man, whether he is a Muslim or not, what is man? What is mankind? Who are we? This is question number one. Number two, what is this universe all around? The third thing, who is God? Who created? These are the fundamental three questions that have to be answered by any philosophy, any religion, any doctrine, and Islam answers all three questions.
Now is the Muslim community is very divided. What do you think about different Africa and something?
Different. You see, the problem with Muslims now. The first problem is they are ignorant of the real source. First problem is that many Muslims, they do not know Arabic language. So without Arabic, because Quran is in Arabic, the Sunnah is in Arabic, the Seerah is in Arabic, so the source of revelation is in Arabic language. So Muslims are not master of Arabic language in many countries, even in Arab countries. This is problem number one. Number two, Muslims, instead of going to Quran and Sunnah, they follow their shuyukh, their peers. They follow their imams. Some of them, they have different groups. Some of them, they say, we are Hanafis, we are Shafi'is, we are Malikis. And they emphasize in such a way that Quran is belittled, the Sunnah is belittled, and Imam becomes more powerful than the Quran and Sunnah. So, I see here in this room, lot of young people. Like, you know, we have this brother sitting in front of me. Are you married?
Not.
So I advise you, don't get married until you learn Arabic language. You see, this is a piece of advice. Because after marriage, you have a lot of problems. You know, you have to take your wife to hospital, you have to take your children to school, you have financial and social, you know, problems. So learn Arabic language first and try to understand the text of Quran directly in Arabic. And try to understand the Sunnah, the Ahadith in original Arabic language. Then, of course, there is no end to knowledge. You can keep on building your knowledge in 30s, in 40s, and 50s, and 60s, and 70s. Until death, you keep on reading and reading, and you enrich your knowledge. The third thing, you should love the entire ummah, even if they are wrong. Even if they are jahil, even if they are ignorant, don't make a new firqa, no new sect, and don't think, well, I learned Arabic language, now I know Quran, I know Sunnah, so I make a new jama'ah, a new group, new sect. No. This is the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, though my ummah is the last ummah, but it came at the end, but it will be in majority on the day of judgment. And we will be more than the Christians, we will be more than the Buddhists, we will be more than the Hindus on the day of judgment. La faqa. You know, I don't make a pride, but my ummah will be the greatest. Be with ummah, know the diseases of ummah, you become a doctor of the ummah. So diseases are many. In Sri Lanka, you have different diseases. In India, we have different diseases. In Saudi Arabia, we have different diseases. In Egypt, we have different diseases. In Japan, we have different diseases. But once you become a good doctor, you will be able to diagnose these diseases and you will decide to cure. And you will decide to dedicate yourself for the health of this ummah, in aqeedah as well as in the deeds and amal. Don't make a new sect. Don't make a new sect. Don't, you know, get proudy and say, well, I am the one who is going to go into Jannah, the rest of the ummah is going to enter the hell. But at the same time, you make a pledge with your Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, I will dedicate my life for da'wah. I will dedicate my life for the health of aqeedah and amal. Keep on doing the work. So we love the ummah. This ummah is the entire mankind, blacks and white. You know, yellow and green, we are all one. From Morocco to Indonesia, we are one. From America to Europe, we are one. Irrespective of colors, irrespective of languages, irrespective of tribes, we are one. This is the ummah of Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes.
I have a question.
Yes.
This might contradict what you just said. We should go back to the original book. But these days, there are many videos, there are speakers on YouTube and on the internet. If you ever watch them, is there anybody who you think are authentic?
You see, first of all, you must develop an ability to judge between A grade and B grade and C grade. for that, initially, you will lose few things also. For example, if you go to market, you don't know the A quality, B quality and C quality, because in the market you have Japanese material and you have Chinese material. You see, you have everything available in the market. So how to know which one is the best? Sometimes you pay more and you get the rotten thing. So again, you should have the knowledge of Quran, you should have the knowledge of Sunnah. Slowly, you know, when you spend 2 years, 3 years in the market, you will come to know, well, this, don't buy this, don't buy this, this is better, this is best. Similarly, if you are sincerely trying to understand Quran and Sunnah, a day will come in which you will be able to distinguish this scholar on YouTube is wrong and this scholar is wrong, right. And he is better, he is medium. He is good, but only one thing is wrong in him. But 99 things are better, good him.
Well, you don't have to tell me who, but is there anybody who you think authentic? You don't have to tell me. I'm going to discover it myself.
You see, as long as somebody is quoting from Quran and authentic Sunnah, they are right. As long as somebody is working for the welfare of Ummah, they are right. For example, you know, I am also doing some job. You will see that on my Facebook, usually I post in Urdu language of Pakistan. I do not quote anything without proper reference. I you know, whatever I write, I give a full reference. I have recorded about more than 300 programs on Peace TV of Zakir Naik. Zakir Naik, I admire him very much, because whenever he talks about Christianity or Islam or Judaism or Hinduism, he gives you proper reference. Unfortunately, this ummah, they don't care about reference. They say, Qala Rasulullah says, Allah says it in the Quran. Let me tell you a joke. A lady called me after Fajr. And she said, this is in Quran. You know, I said, this is not in Quran. She said, I swear to my Allah, this is in Quran, I read 5 minutes ago. I told her, I swear to Allah, this is not in the Quran. You know, she hanged and she put the phone and she said, I will call you after 5 minutes. And after 5 minutes, she called me again. So I asked her, is it under the text of Quran what you read, or is it on the footnote somewhere down on the right, left, or there? So she said, no, it is not the translation, it is the footnote in the Quran. So I told her, the footnote is not the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Footnote is written by some scholar. So the Ummah has to distinguish between the actual words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the actual words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the interpretation, your interpretation could be right or my interpretation could be right, that, and I must tell that this is my opinion, I could be wrong. But this is what Allah said and this is what Rasulullah said, and I should provide a reference to it. Any other question? Yes, brother.
My question is related to my brother. This is the best time to basically divide our nation into different sections. So we will try our best to don't create a new section. But what about the old section? Because as there is any way that we can assemble all these sections on the same table in the agenda?
No, what I'm saying, you know, in answer to brother's question and this brother's question. What I said, listen to me. Every country has certain problems, certain diseases. Every sect has a problem. But let me explain to you, to be very precise. You have to draw a line. Is that sect within Islam or outside Islam? If, for example, if a sect is saying that Ali is God, for example, the Bashar al-Assad of Syria, he is not a Muslim. His father, Hafiz al-Assad, was not a Muslim. He is an Alawi, he is a Nusayri. They believe Ali as their God. Ali karramallahu wajha, Ali bin Abi Talib as their God. They are very known people. Nusayr was in 280 Hijri. They are Nusayris. Later on, French people named them Alawites. So they are not Muslims. They are not Muslims. Similarly, those who worship Ali as God, or those who consider Ali as the Prophet of Islam, Nabi. Now, those who consider Ali not a God, not a Prophet, but they think he is a superhuman being, Superman, we don't consider them kafir, but we consider them wrong. We can talk to them, we can have a dialogue with them. You know, if they are not kafir, they are our brothers, but they are fasiq. Their aqidah is wrong, their amal is wrong, they are people of Ahlul Bid'ah. They have bid'ah. So, we have to make dawah among Ahlul Bid'ah. You see? But don't make them kafir. So similarly, we have Sufis. So Sufis are of different kinds. Some are 2% wrong, some are 5% wrong, some are 20% wrong, some are 50% wrong, some are 100% wrong. They are not non-Muslims. Those who have strange concepts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and tells them, and they have certain, so, and Quran is not important, Sunnah is not important. Those Sufis, we don't consider Muslims. Those who do not believe in Sharia, those who do not believe in five time prayers, they are outside. But the other Sufis, if they have 2% or 3% wrong, they are our brothers. We have to make dawah. You know, for example, in a hospital, lot of patients come. You know, sometimes doctors give them some medicine, okay, you're all right, after 2 weeks you'll be all right, no problem. Sometimes he admits and said, no, you have to be in the hospital for 1 month. Sometimes he says, I have to cut and operate. So the patients are of different degrees. First of all, brothers, you have to become a doctor. You have to love the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You should have knowledge of a doctor. Then only you can treat them. If you don't have the proper knowledge of diseases and complete examination of that person, you cannot make the treatment. So, for example, you have a man of bid'ah. So you should make X-ray. You should make, you know, MRI. You have to have, you know, all those tests. Examine him, then you pass a judgment. You know, I have to treat him. But don't become a mufti. Become a da'i. You know, a famous scholar of Egypt, you know, he wrote a book, Nahnu Du'a La Qudat. You know this. That we are not judges. We are inviters. We are inviting people. We are not dividing ummah. But we should know the diseases. We have to treat the patients. We should know different sects. But they are our brothers. Even if they are wrong, they are our brothers. This is the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.